You got your Bibles, turn to Matthew 1. Am I? Help me, Chad. And verse 21. Go to Luke chapter 19 and verse 10. Put your finger there. I don't know if y'all can do this. And then go back to John. Put your other hand in John chapter 3. And we're going to share a few things this morning. And I'll preach fast if you'll listen fast. Somebody say amen. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall,
amen.
I like that.
Yes, sir.
Save his people,
amen,
from their sins.
Amen.
Turn to Luke chapter number 19 and verse number 10. Luke chapter 19 and verse number 10. When you're there, say amen.
Yes, sir. Amen.
For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save,
amen,
that which was lost.
Praise God.
Turn to John chapter number 3 and just kind of open there, and I'm going to take you through the Bible. I love the book of John. It's a wonderful book. In chapter number 1, it talks about a wonderful word.
Yeah.
Chapter number 2 through 11, it talks about wonderful works.
Yeah.
Chapter 12 through 18 talks about a wonderful way. In chapter 19 and chapter 20, it talks about wonderful wounds. Can I tell you something? All I can say about Jesus this morning is he is wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Can you say it with us? Say it together. Jesus is
wonderful.
Praise God.
Amen.
I want the theme. You've already got the theme for the service this morning, and I want to share it. And it's simple. It's two words. I want to shout it over the mountain today. Jesus saves. Can you? Let's all say it together. I want the whole church to say it. Every one of you can participate. Let's all do it together.
Jesus saves.
Man, I don't even know if y'all believe that or not. Let's do it one more time. Everybody together. Let's do it together.
Jesus saves.
That's a little bit better, but I think you could do better. Let's tell Jesus. Let's tell the whole world right now. One more time.
Jesus saves.
Hallelujah. I'm going to be your usher. And the Holy Spirit's going to be your guide. And I am going to illustrate 7 ways. That might be a minute per way, but I'll give you 7 ways. 7 proofs that Jesus saves right from the Gospel of John. And I'll let you listen, then you can go home and read the scriptures when you go home. Amen? John chapter number 3. We are introduced to a man. His name is Nicodemus. He's religious. But he's lost. The saddest commentary today is for a person to be religious and yet lost. Nicodemus was a religious ruler. He came to Jesus by night. And by the way, friend, Jesus saves proves one thing with Nicodemus. Jesus can save those that are disqualified by sin. Can I say this to you? Your religion won't get you to heaven. Being a member of Taze Valley Baptist Church will not get you to heaven. You one day going up in a baptistry some way will not get you to heaven. Somebody help me preach right here. I feel a little bit of preaching coming on. You turning over a new leaf will not get you to heaven. There's people right now. This is about the saddest, most pathetic thing I could say. There's people right now that's going to a confessional and they're confessing their sins to a man. And then he is going to say a few words over them. And then he's going to take communion. And they believe that that bread will turn literally into the body, and he's going to eat the body. And that wine will turn right into the blood. And he's going to drink the blood. And Jesus will have a sacrifice right then, there, at that church. Can I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, we have one mediator between God and man. His name is Jesus Christ. And I want you to know, if you're dependent on your religion to go to heaven this morning, if you're dependent on your good works to go to heaven this morning, you are disqualified. But Jesus saves those that are disqualified by sin. Amen. Then if you, and don't turn, just stay with me. That way I can go at a more rapid pace. Then Jesus in chapter 4, he makes a statement that he must needs go through Samaria. Samaria was the long way around. Samaria was the way the Jews would not go. But Jesus went there. Because see, there was a woman there who was wicked, who was ungodly. Jesus even posed a question to her. Where's your husband? And she said, I don't have one. I had five. Sounds like modern America to me. And the one I have right now is not my husband. She was shacking up. She went through five marriages. You know why I think she did all that? To find satisfaction. Can I tell you something? Jesus saves those that are dissatisfied by sin. I say this to you this morning. If you've come to this church and you're sick of your sin, you're sick of the dissatisfaction, you're sick of the sadness, you're sick of the burden of sin, you've not been satisfied, you've tried everything to be satisfied, can I tell you this morning, Jesus saves. And if you go to the end of this chapter, chapter 4, Lord have mercy, I sent some preach on me. If you go to the end of the chapter, chapter 4, there was a nobleman there. And he was seeking Jesus that he might heal his diseased son. Whew, I'm about to get happy. And he came to Jesus and he cried out in desperation, my son needs healed. And Jesus just looked at him. He said, the reason you're here, you want to see a miracle. But he said, I want to tell you something. You going home, your boy's already healed. And the Bible said that he believed. I want you to know something. Here's faith. Faith is believing that Jesus saves and Jesus is going to do the miracle before the miracle's ever done. And I say to you that Jesus saves those that are diseased by sin. Ladies and gentlemen, we come into this world diseased by sin. But he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Chapter 5, I'm hurrying. He goes to a pool called Siloam. There was a man there that could not walk. 38 years of it. And here's the custom. An angel would come down and trouble the water. And the person that could get to the water while it was still moving would be healed. What an improbability. Jesus saves those that are disabled by sin. We can't get to God, but he came to us. How many can wave your hand at me and say, I'm glad for the day he came where I was and he saved me by his grace. And we were unable to save ourselves. We had total inability, but thank God Jesus saves. And then we'll move a little quicker to chapter 8. I'm giving y'all 8 sermons in 8 minutes, so y'all be thankful. We'll move to chapter 8. There was a woman taken in adultery. How many know the story? And they were all there getting ready to stone her. And Jesus was there. And he was sitting there before her as her judge. Then he stooped down before her and wrote into the sand. Some people say, what in the world did he write? I ain't sure, but I think I might know. The custom is, if you were going to stone somebody, the woman and the people had to be named, or the people that had had an affair with her. I believe he wrote that down, because then he got up and he said, you without sin, cast the first stone. He was sitting before her, whew, as judge. He stooped below her as Savior, and he stood by her as friend. Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Not only does Jesus saves you from the defilement of sin. Sin defiles. Sin, wickedness defiles. But thank God, when you get saved, you get a robe of righteousness. Almost done. You keep saying, my Lord, I'm going to be here by 1 o'clock. Chapter number 9. We have another person in chapter number 9 that Jesus moves into the scene in her life. Well, his life, excuse me. Man that was born blind from his mother. And Jesus came, and everybody was asked the question, who sinned? Him or his parents? What a dumb question. He was born blind. And Jesus has done the unthinkable. He got him some dirt. By the way, isn't it kind of appropriate to get dirt? That's what we was made out of. He got him some dirt, and he spit in it. That sounds kind of unethical. Spit in it. Greg, he made a mud pie. Now, I'm not going to put my spit in your face, okay?
All right.
I'll use the back of my hand.
I've had worse.
He put the mud and the spit on the man's eyes.
Amen.
And he said, go down to the pool of Siloam.
Yes.
And the man by faith went. You said, well, what was so magical about that? How in the world could a mud pie with spit in it heal anybody?
Yeah. Woo!
Mmm. Mmm. Do you know what they do if they want to check your DNA?
Yep.
You know what they do? They'll bring a swab.
Yep.
And they'll swab you. And they'll take your saliva. And they'll give you your DNA. You said, what happened that day? Same thing that happened the day you got saved. He put his DNA on your DNA, and his DNA caused you to see, and you can see today because of the marvelous power of the grace of God that Jesus saved. Somebody say amen. Those that were darkened by sin, one day we couldn't see. One day we were blind. One day we were blinded by the God of this world, but Jesus opened up the door.
Amen.
I'll be done. I'll take you one more place. I'm done. I'm trying to catch my breath. I'm done. Jesus had a friend, actually three friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. He heard that his friend was sick and about to die. And Jesus let him die.
Yeah, he did.
Somebody help me.
Come on now. Amen.
He got drunk yard dead. 4 days dead. Nod your head at me. All the way dead. And then Jesus came and Martha said to Mary, the master has come and calleth for thee. Whoa! How many remember the day when the master came and called for you? And Jesus walked up to the tomb. And by the way, there are human responsibility here. He said, roll away the stone. And he made this statement, Lazarus, come forth. If he had just said, come forth, everything in the graveyard that came forth. And Lazarus came hopping out of the grave. And he said, loose him.
And let him go.
And let him go. The Bible says that we were dead in trespasses and sin. Couldn't make our way to God. But I want you to know Jesus saves those that are dead by sin. I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
Amen.
Jesus saves. He came into the scene of seven people's life. And he's not quit that. I remember January 31st, 1973. He made a visit to me.
Amen.
Oh, I want you to know he's in here this morning. And he's making a visit to you right now. You're lost, you're undone, you're without God and his son. And he's making a visit saying to you, I'll save you. All you got to do is come. Bow your head with me. Heads bowed, eyes closed. No one looking around. How many right now say, Preacher Smith, I know that Jesus saves because he saved me. Raise your hand if you know it. Hold my pie. Thank you. How many in this room couldn't raise your hand? Before you die, before the Lord comes, you want him to save you. And you couldn't raise your hand, but you want to be saved before he comes, before you die. You want to know Christ. Would you slip your hand up right now? Just slip it up high. Say, Preacher, I've never been saved, but I want to be. Just slip it up. Slip it up. God bless that hand. Somebody else. Just slip it up. If God spoke to you, I want you to come forward. Stand with me. Stand with me. Father, right now you bless the invitation. Thank you for the good service. Thank you for all the great things that happened today. Now bless, we pray, in Jesus' name, for his sake, amen. Let's sing.
Amen.
Yeah,
there's mercy with the Lord.
Oh, yes.
And he will surely give you rest by trusting.
Amen. Trust him.
Only trust him now.
Find God. will save you.
He will save you. He will
thank you.
Save you.
Amen. When you leave today, I want every family to get one of these. This is our 2020 vision calendar. And we want to give you one of them for your family. Aren't you glad he saves? Our Father, right now as we dismiss, I pray you touch people. That God, those that raise their hand needing to be saved will come back tonight and get saved. Put conviction on them, Lord. And we'll praise you in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen.